This is Adventist World Radio, broadcasting in English from Pune.
Hello and a warm welcome to you as you join us.
In our program today, we bring music from celestial singers and heritage singers.
A nature study on baboons.
Followed by a story for children.
Our thought for the day is taken from God's Word on the topic, 7 days in the week. I'm Sophia.
I'm Sharad.
And you're listening to Adventist World Radio, the voice of hope.
To begin, here's a song entitled, The Lord is My Shepherd.
The Celestial Singers on Adventist World Radio. For more details about our program, we request you to write to us on
Adventist World Radio, Post Box Number 17, Pune 411001, Maharashtra, India.
Over to our friend Diamond for a story entitled Wise Old Tom.
Hello everyone. Some people think cats are dumb. And Mr. Paddock thought so too for a long time. He felt that dogs had brains and used them, but somehow he couldn't feel that way about cats. But he changed his mind after some observations. One day, his little boy of 7 came home with a fluffy little kitten in his arms. Mr. Paddock and his family supposed it belonged to a neighbor, and he had just brought it home to show it to them. But no, the 7-year-old boy wanted to keep it. Mr. Paddock wasn't at all enthusiastic about it, but he had some mice about the place, and Mrs. Paddock finally said he might have the kitten. He was named Tommy, which, when he grew older, was shortened to just plain Tom. Tom became one of the family and really won his way into their hearts. One spring, it was decided that the family were going on a trip, and the question arose as to what they might do with Tom. They felt they wouldn't have any trouble in getting someone to care for him, for he had a lovely disposition and made friends of those who called to visit them. On learning of the family's plans, some friends asked if they might take Tom and care for him. The friends lived on the other side of a big city, about 5 miles away from the Paddock home, so Tom had to be taken across the city. The family put him in a cloth bag, much to his displeasure. They placed him in the back of the car and took him across town. You may wonder why they had to put him in a sack. They felt it would be just as well if he didn't see where he was going, for they had heard of dogs and cats trying to find their way back home. Surely, if old Tom was in a bag and couldn't see where they went, he wouldn't attempt to return home. When they got to the home of their friends, the family picked up the bag, cat and all, and took them into the house. He was happy to get out of the sack, but didn't feel at home at all. The family left him there, thinking he would adjust himself to his new surroundings in a few hours. The first time they opened the door, he darted out and disappeared. Of course, they were worried about him, but they could not find him. A few days later, he was seen back at the family's home. The family's neighbors watched him trying to get into the house. They wondered if the family would go away and leave the cat without food and shelter. He stayed around for several days and then was not seen anymore. He went back across town to the friend's home. The family received a letter from the friends which said, "Old Tom is back. He was tired and hungry and is now glad to stay with us. He made himself at home and stayed there contentedly until the Paddocks returned some weeks later."
You heard Diamond with a story on Adventist World Radio, the voice of hope for all.
Time to hear a song by Heritage Singers entitled "Rain Your Love."
For the clouds to cry, rain your love from a heaven high. I need you, Lord, I need you, Lord. Your love is fresh, it's falling rain. It calms my spirit, soothes the pain. Somewhere I went wrong again. I need you, Lord, I need you. Precious love on me again. Let it fill this empty cup. Let it quench this thirst for love that's killing me. With too much sun, the flower dies. So withered in my haste, river parched a barren waste. Now I long for just a taste of your sweet love, your sweet love. Won't you rain your precious love on me again? Let it quench this thirst for love that's killing me.
We invite you to listen to a message presented by Frederick Paul on God's Word entitled 7 days in the week.
7 days in the week. Why are there just seven? Why not 10 or some other number? Well, why not? Did you ever wonder about it? In the first place, the word week comes from the same root as the word seven. It really means a period of 7 days, not 10 days or 5 days or 3 days, but 7 days. So we see that the word week really signifies seven. Where did the week start and who started it? According to the Encyclopedia Britannica, 11th edition, volume 6, page 988. Calendar, the week, being a period of 7 days, has no reference whatever to the motions of the stars or of the sun or of the moon. And those who reject the Mosaic recital, that is, what the Bible says about it, will be at a loss to assign it to an origin having much semblance of probability, and that is certainly true. The free-running week is not connected with any natural division of time, such as the month or the year. As we trace the records back through the centuries, they lead us closer and closer to the Bible story, which is, God created all things, including man, in 6 days, and then rested on the seventh day, after which he blessed and sanctified it, thus setting it apart for a holy use. This is clearly stated in the first and second chapters of Genesis, and is all summed up in the first three verses of the second chapter as follows. Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 to 3, comprises of how the Lord created the whole world in 6 days, and then he rested on the seventh day. 1500 years later, we find Noah measuring time by a period of 7 days, Genesis 8 and verse 10. And nearly 700 years later still, we read of a young man very much in love who had to wait 7 days in order to be married, Genesis 29:27. Smith's Bible Dictionary says, its antiquity is so great, its observance so widespread, that it has generally been thrown back as far as the creation of man. The week and the Sabbath are, if this be so, as old as man himself. So you see, the week of 7 days marked off by the Sabbath at its end is very old indeed, as old as man himself. In the beginning, and in the Bible references, the days of the week were numbered from 1 to 7, or the Sabbath. But when the people drifted away from the worship of the true God, the days of the week were dedicated by the Chaldeans, Egyptians, and others to the sun, moon, and planets. These heathen peoples worshipped as gods the sun, moon, and five planets visible to the naked eye, which together were known as the seven planets. And they assigned each hour of the day to one of these planetary gods in rotation. The first hour of the first day, as we have it now, was assigned to the sun. Therefore, that day was called Sunday. And so they went through the 24 hours of the day, dedicating each hour to one of the seven planets in the order that they were supposed to have their revolutions in the heaven. And when they came to the first hour of the second day, it was found by this system to correspond to the moon. So the day was called Moon's Day or Monday. And so on through all the days of the week. The names were given by pagan astrologers who worshipped the heavenly bodies. We cannot take time to explain in detail here just how the names of the planet gods were changed to our present names, Mars Day to Tuesday, for instance, but a book by Robert Arnhem makes it all plain and most intensely interesting. The day dedicated by the heathen to Saturn, the day now called Saturday, was the same as the seventh day of the week called the Sabbath or rest day by God and so observed by the Israelites. This is proved by history. Dio Cassius, the Roman historian, says that Pompey captured Jerusalem by attacking on the day of Saturn, which was the same as the Sabbath observed by the Jews. On that day, the Jews would not fight, so the city was taken. This was 63 years before Christ, so we have the identity of Saturday with the Sabbath made certain from that time to the present, because the millions of Jews still consider the seventh day to be holy, and it still coincides with the day called Saturday in the calendar. Another thing to remember on this subject is that Julius Caesar made a scientific adjustment in the calendar in the year 46 BC, and the same calendar with a slight change regarding the months, which had nothing to do with the continuity of the days of the week, is the very calendar that's on your desk right now. So the unbroken recurrence of the days of the week has come to us from before the days of Christ, as we see from the universal fact of the existence and custom of the Jews all over the earth, the testimony of history and the scientific accuracy of the calendar. To this, we must add also the records and practice of the Roman Catholic Church in considering Sunday the first day of the week, the day on which Christ arose from the dead. The Greek Catholics and Protestants, who also agree with this, and the Mohammedans, who observe Friday as the sixth day of the week. Now let us go back to the beginning and work forward to modern times. In the first chapter of Genesis and in the first three verses of the second chapter, we read about the origin of the week with its 7 days marked off by the Sabbath. Let us read the third verse again, Genesis 2:3. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. This says that God sanctified the seventh day. To sanctify is rendered hallowed in the fourth commandment and is defined as to pronounce holy, to institute any holy thing, to appoint, and is repeatedly used in the Bible for a public announcement or proclamation. The most striking illustration of the meaning of this word sanctify is found in the record of the sanctification of Mount Sinai. In Exodus 19, verses 12 and 13, Moses was charged by God to tell the people to set bounds about the mount and to sanctify it. In other words, to sanctify Mount Sinai or to set it apart for a holy use. And so, while the declaration in Genesis 2:3 that God blessed the seventh day and sanctified is not a commandment for the observance of that day, it is the record that such a precept was given to Adam, and with it the knowledge of the week of 7 days. These words, "he sanctified it," are a blank unless in reference to some who were required to keep it holy. The lives of only two men bridged the years from Adam to Abraham, so that the wonderful record of creation and the story of Eden would be passed on from father to son. We are told that Adam lived 930 years or until Lamech, the father of Noah, was 56 years of age. Lamech lived until Shem, the son of Noah, was 93, and Shem lived until Abraham was 150 years old. How eager the people must have been for nearly 1,000 years to see the first man to talk with Adam. who had himself talked with God, and to hear from his lips a description of that paradise in which he had lived, to hear from the lips of one created on the sixth day the story of creation week and the very words of the Creator when he set apart his day to a holy use. Someone asks, was the knowledge of the week lost in Egypt when the people of promise were in bondage? The answer is no, because when they came over the Red Sea and camped in the wilderness, they had not forgotten the days of the week. You have all heard the story of the manna. The record is in the 16th chapter of Exodus. In verse 22, we are informed that they went out on the sixth day and gathered twice as much as on other days so that they would have food over the Sabbath, the seventh day on which no manna fell. For 40 years, this miracle of the manna, a double supply on the sixth day and none on the seventh day, continued. Certainly an unforgettable lesson on the existence of the week and God's attitude toward the same Sabbath which marks it off. So you see, the Israelites knew the days and had not forgotten them in Egypt. In Exodus chapter 20, we find the fourth commandment. Exodus 20, 8 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. This brings us to an understanding how important the Sabbath is. Notice especially that the fourth commandment traces the obligation of Sabbath back to creation. So you see, this identifies the Sabbath and the week, and of the fourth commandment with the Sabbath and the week of creation. This brings us to the 800 years or more that the Israelites were in the Holy Land. Did they lose track of the week of 7 days during that time? Hardly. Firstly, there were strict laws in force regarding it. Read it in Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Number two, special offerings were made in the temple on the Sabbath. This giving of offerings marked off the week and kept the correct count of the days. Number three, the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Amos and others were sent by the Lord to remind the people of God's commandments and to correct them when they went astray. Isaiah 56:2-6, Isaiah 58:13. These passages show that the people knew the days of the week all right, but were careless about observing the seventh day as many are today. Next, we come to the time of Jesus Christ. When he came to this earth, the Jews were super strict in observing the seventh day as the Sabbath. In fact, they were so afraid that the people might profane it and as a result go into captivity again that they hedged the Sabbath about with dozens of man-made laws and regulations and made it a burden instead of a blessing. You will remember that they found fault with Jesus because he permitted his disciples to rub a little wheat in their hands and eat the kernels when they were hungry one Sabbath day. In the fifth chapter of John is recorded that these ancient blue law advocates actually went so far as to try to kill Jesus because he healed a poor sick man on the Sabbath. They accused Christ of being a Sabbath breaker and when he had only ignored their man-made restrictions and human traditions. They knew when the Sabbath day came, all right, they had not lost track of the week. But they had lost sight of God's beneficent plan for the Sabbath. Christ was the Son of God. He was with the Heavenly Father in the work of creation and the making of the Sabbath in the beginning. And he said to his critics in Mark 2:27-28, the Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man's good. And Christ claimed to be Lord of it because he was with God in the beginning and was himself the active agent in the creation of all things. Let us not make the same mistake as those men long ago who forgot the meaning of the week with the Sabbath, God's holy reminder at its close, and drifted off into spiritual night. May we be among those servants of Christ, of whom it is said, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." Revelation 14:12.
Thank you, Frederick Paul, for being on our program and sharing God's Word.
We hope you've been benefited from our program. You are listening to the Voice of Hope from Pune, India.
May God continue to bless you as you learn and understand more about His love.
God invites us to pray so that we will know Him more fully as our loving Father and understand ourselves more clearly as well. Even as a parent gives more and more responsibility to a child as he or she grows, so the Lord expects us to take responsibility for seeking and following His direction.
With this, we come to the end of our program. For the ones who wish to know more on God's Word, here's our mailing address. Adventist World Radio, Post Box number 17, Pune 411001, Maharashtra, India.
That is Adventist World Radio, Post Box number 17, Pune 411001, Maharashtra, India.
You could also email us on anc3@vsnl.com.
That's anc3@vsnl.com. I'm Sharad.
And I'm Sophia, signing out from Adventist World Radio.
Remember to join us again.
Until then, may you enjoy God's nature and His love.
Goodbye, and God bless you.